Hello, thank you very much for the invitation to speak here. So today I'm going to talk about mixing and heating times for Markov chains. And both mixing and heating times are among the most fundamental notions for Markov chains, and they have both been studied for many years. And already yesterday and during the rest of the week, we are going to see a lot of talks on how to bound mixing times. Heating times are closely related to potential theory techniques, and one can determine them by solving linear systems. And in my talk today, I'm going to explain a connection between them. And in my talk on Thursday, I'm going to show some applications of this work. I know that the notation was introduced later, yesterday, but just to have it all for the talk, I'm just going to introduce very quickly here. So X is always going to be, again, an irreducible Markov chain. And always on a finite state space. And I'm going to write PTXY for the transition probability in T steps. And since X is irreducible on a finite state space, we have a unique invariant distribution pi. And so that pi is equal to pi p. And I'm going to denote by t mix the total variation mixing time, which was introduced yesterday. So it's the first time that the total variation distance between the measure starting from x and the stationary measure is smaller than a quarter. And I want to take the worst starting state. So I'll take the max over all x. It's standard to use here the value quarter, but one could define t mix of epsilon and just replace the quarter here by epsilon. But when I don't write anything, I will just mean a quarter. And let me remind you quickly that a chain is called reversible if pi x pxy is pi of y pyx for all xy. Or in other words, if we start the Markov chain from stationarity and we run it backwards or forwards in time, then the two chains look indistinguishable. And in order to avoid periodicity or near periodicity issues, just like Yuval yesterday, I'm going to consider the lazy version of the chain, which means that with probability half, we stay in place, and with probability half, we jump to a state y, which is chosen according to the transition matrix P. So the lazy chain has transition matrix PL, which is P plus I over 2. And from now on, all my chains are going to be lazy, so I'm not going to say that every time. And the last piece of notation, tau A, is going to define it to denote the first heating time of the set A. Okay, so now I'm ready to state the first theorem. I'm going to present most of the proof of this theorem today. And then I will give some remarks. So this was proved jointly with Yuval and also independently by Roberto Oliveira from IMPA in Brazil. And what it says is that for all reversible chains, and I always consider them to be lazy, so the mixing time is up to constants. I'll explain what that means. It's up to constants equal to the maximum overall starting states x and sets a that have substantial measure, say bigger than an eighth, of the expectation starting from x to hit a. And let me explain what I mean by this symbol. Let me call that th. So what this symbol means is that there exist universal positive constants, C1 and C2, so that the mixing time is upper bounded by one of the constants times this quantity and lower bounded by the other constant times the same quantity. And the important point is that these constants are universal for all reversible chains, no matter what the transition matrix is or the size of the state space. So there exists C1 and C2 positive, such that for all reversible chains, T mix is upper bounded by C1 TH and lower bounded. Okay, before I discuss the proof, I would like to state a related result which was proved by David Aldous in the 80s. Is it clear? Yeah, sorry. It's the maximum overall starting states x and all sets a, but I am only looking at sets with which have measure at least 1/8. So Aldous in 81 showed that for all reversible chains, T mix is equivalent to the maximum, and now I'm taking the maximum over all starting states x and all sets a, but I'm going to multiply the heating time of a by the measure of a. So here we see that if a set a is big, then it means that it has big stationary measure, but then the time to heat it is going to be small. On the other hand, if a is a small set, then it has small measure and it would take long to heat it. So these two quantities, the product balances out in the end. And here we see that the maximum is over all sets A, while in this theorem I wrote here, we only restrict to sets A that have substantial measure. And as you can see, the lower bound, that the mixing time is at least this quantity, follows immediately from this theorem. But it's also very intuitive, because if we have not hit a big set, then we know we cannot have mixed. And the difficult direction is to show that the mixing time is upper bounded by this quantity. I would like to make one remark. So what Aldous actually showed is that the mixing time of the continuous time chain is equivalent to this quantity. But it's a standard fact that the continuous time mixing and the mixing of the lazy chain are equivalent up to constants. So although I said that the lower bound here follows immediately from Aldous, since it's very intuitive and it's just a one-line proof, let me prove it here. The mix is, so when I write this symbol, I mean it's just up to constants. It's greater than this quantity. So let me take T to be the mixing time at 1 over 16, so epsilon is 1 over 16. Then we have the T mix of 1 over 16. It's easy to check that it's at most 3 times T mix. This follows by the submultiplicativity property of the total variation distance, of the D bar distance that Yuval defined yesterday. So since T is chosen to be T mix at 1 over 16, it means that at this time, the total variation distance is 1 over 16. So for all x and a, the probability to go from x to a is at least pi of a minus 1 over 16. So let's take A with pi of A at least an eighth. Then for all x, we have that ptxa is at least 1 over 16. So this means that we can upper bound the heating. Since this holds for all x, we can perform independent geometric experiments. And so we can upper bound the heating time of A by t times a geometric random variable of parameter 1 over 16. And so this gives and that's the proof for the lower bound. So now I would like to explain the proof of the upper bound. And in order to do that, I'm going to introduce a new notion of mixing, which we call mixing at a geometric time. So I'm just going to take Zt to be a geometric random variable with success probability 1 over t. And it's going to be independent of the Markov chain x. And I'm going to define tg of t to be, I'm just going to take the total variation distance from stationarity when we sample the Markov chain at this independent geometric time. So it's going to be the max over all x of the distance between these two measures. And z is independent of x. So now I can define the mixing at the geometric time tg to be the first time, so that this total variation distance is smaller than a quarter. And what we showed with Yuval is that this geometric mixing is equivalent for all reversible chains. Tg is equivalent to the mixing time. And in order to prove that, I might explain it a little bit later, but the proof follows in a similar way to the way that Aldous established his result. And one needs to define some other notions of mixing. But I'm not going to go into detail. But what I'm going to show is that for all chains, and here we do not require the chain to be reversible, we have the Tg is equivalent to the maximum heating time, to the quantity TH. So let me prove. So let me prove that. And again, the lower bound that the mixing is at least the heating time. This is very intuitive and follows in the same way as before, so I'm just going to focus on the upper bound. So we'll show that Tg is upper bounded by constant times Th. So let me take T, which is smaller than Tg. So what the goal is, I want to find a set B which has big measure trying to set B with big measure, and when I say big, I mean at least an eighth, and such that the maximum overall x of the expected time to hit B, I want that to be at least theta times t for some constant theta. I just take some t which is smaller than tg. So if we prove that, then clearly we are done. So since I took t which is smaller than tg, it means that at this time the chain is not mixed. And so it follows that we have a bad starting state z and the set A, so that starting from Z, the probability that we are in A after Z steps is going to be small. So there exists a bad starting state Z and the set A such that the probability we are in A at this time Zt is at most pi of A minus a quarter. So from this inequality, we immediately get that pi of A is at least a quarter. So we have found a big set, the set A, but this is not going to be the set we want, because for A, although it has big measure, but we have also a bad starting state, the state z. But in fact, we're going to use A to define the set B. And the idea is that since A has big measure, although there is one bad starting state for A, most states cannot be bad, simply because pi is stationary. So let me explain that formally. So let me define the set B to be the set of points Y so these are the set of good points, the points Y, so that starting from Y, the probability we are in A after Z steps is at least pi of A minus an eighth. And as I said before, since A has big measure, I'm going to show now that B also has big measure. So since pi is stationary, we have that pi of A is equal to the sum over all Y because Z is independent of the Markov chain. And now I'm just going to split this sum into the y's that are in B and the y's that are not in B. For the y's that are in B, I'm just going to upper bound this sum simply by pi of B. And if y is not in B, then this is upper bounded by pi of A minus an eighth. So we get that pi of A is upper bounded by this sum, and so that immediately gives that pi of B is at least an eighth. So we showed that B has big measure, and all that remains to show is that the time to hit B is at least a constant times t. And in order to do that, I'm going to prove it by contradiction. So what I mean, assume that this maximum is smaller than a constant, than theta times t. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to do some calculations and find the right value of theta that will lead to a contradiction. And the contradiction will be about the bad starting state z. Okay? So assume that for theta to be determined. This and as I said, the contradiction will be about the starting state z. So let me write this probability. I'm just going to lower bound it by the probability that zt is after the first heating time of b. And let me take m to be a positive integer. So I just inserted more events here. Tau b smaller than 2 theta mt and zt after the first heating time of b. And now I'm just going to condition and multiply by the probability of this event. And now I'm going to use the strong Markov property at the stopping time tau b together with the memoryless property of the geometric to say that this probability here is at least the minimum overall w in b of the probability starting from w that xzt is in a times this probability. But this probability, I'm just going to lower bound it by the probability that zt is at least 2 theta mt and tau b is less than that. So from the definition of the set B, we know that this probability is at least pi of a minus an eighth. And now z and tau are independent because z was chosen to be an independent geometric independent of the Markov chain. So this is simply the product of the two. And z is geometric, so this probability is at least 1 minus 2 theta m. And by Markov's inequality, this is 1 minus 1 over 2m. Okay? Because this is by Markov's, assuming that this maximum is smaller than theta times t. I have assumed that, and then I want that to lead us to a contradiction. So the probability that tau b is less than 2 theta mt is at least that. So now if I take theta, I just want to make these two equal, so I'm just going to take it to be 1 over 4m squared. Then this will give me pi of a minus an eighth times 1 minus 1 over 2m squared. And if I take m large enough, this is going to be bigger than pi of a minus a quarter. And this is the contradiction because we showed that if we assume that and theta is 1 over 4m squared for some m sufficiently large, then the probability starting from z that we hit a after z in number of steps is at least pi of a minus a quarter, and this contradicts the assumption that z was a bad starting state. So is this proof clear? So I want to show that the geometric mixing was upper bounded by this maximum heating time. So what we want to do is to find a big set which has this property, that the maximum heating time of this set is at least a constant times this time tg. And since we took t smaller than tg, we had one bad starting state and one big set A, and then we use this set to define a good set B, which has big measure. And then assuming that we hit B, assuming that the time to hit B is small, gives a contradiction for the choice of the starting state Z. Okay, so this shows that Tg is equivalent to Th for all chains, as I said, no reversibility assumption. I would like to make some remarks about the first theorem and the reversibility assumption here. So, reversibility is essential in theorem one. And the reason for that is consider a biased random walk on the cycle. With 2/3 we move to the right, with 1/3 we move to the left. Then the mixing time is still of order n squared. However, the walk has positive speed, so any set of substantial measure is going to be hit in linear time. The second remark is about the choice of the number 1/8 in the theorem. So this was arbitrary just to make the calculations work on the board. We actually proved that for all alpha strictly smaller than 1/2, if I replace the 1/8 here by alpha, and I just write the h alpha here, then t mix is equivalent, and the constants depend on the constant alpha, to th of alpha. So we showed that both in our work and also Roberto Oliveira proved it for all alpha strictly smaller than 1/2. But the constants here, as I said, depend on alpha, and as alpha approaches 1/2, our constants and his constants would explode. But then this was improved by Simon Griffiths with Kang, Oliveira, and Patel, and they showed, working directly with heating times, they showed that th of alpha is upper bounded by 1 over alpha times th of 1/2. So this shows that the theorem also holds for alpha equal to 1/2. And remark 3 is that it doesn't hold if alpha is strictly bigger than 1/2. It works all the way up to 1/2, but if alpha is bigger than 1/2, then conclusion doesn't hold. And a simple counterexample is to take two complete graphs, Kn, and we join them by a single edge. Then if we take any set of measures strictly bigger than 1/2, then it's going to have points on both sides. So if A has pi of A bigger than 1/2, then the expected time to hit A is going to be of order n. it's going to be at most n over nx. While, so th is of this alpha is going to be n, while for the mixing time we have to cross the bottleneck, and so the mixing time is going to be of order n squared. So next, I would like to talk a little bit about stationary and strong stationary times. And the usefulness of these times was first discovered by Aldous and Iconis in their 87 paper. So I'm going to define all these notions and show how strong stationary times can be used to upper bound mixing times. And I'll also give some examples. And then I'm going to talk about another notion of mixing, which was used by Aldous and Lovas and Winkler to show equivalences of different notions of mixing. In particular here, we use it to show the equivalence between the geometric mixing and the heating time. So,
geometric mixing and
regular. Sorry, yes. So, before I define stationary times, I'm going to define what is a randomized stopping time. So suppose that we have a filtration, Fn, with respect to which x is Markovian. So what it means is that the probability that xn plus 1 is in some set given fn is the same as the probability xn plus 1 given only the sigma algebra generated by xn. And also we want xn to be adapted to this filtration. So xn is in fn for all n. So this is what I mean when I say that X is Markov with respect to some filtration. So this filtration could be larger than just the natural filtration. It could include extra randomness. So now let me define. I guess before defining the randomized stopping time, I'll give an example. So because I think this is instructive, so this is also in the paper of Aldous and Iconis. Let's consider a lazy, simple random walk on the hypercube 0, 1 to the n. Then how can we realize that? One way to realize it is by picking at every step, we pick a coordinate at random, and we refresh the bit at this coordinate with a uniform bit. So let JB be uniform on 1 up to n multiplied by 0, 1. So J corresponds to the coordinate that we pick, and B is the bit that we put in this coordinate. So that's the way to realize a lazy simple random walk on the hypercube. And let me define now tau refresh to be the first time that we have touched all of the coordinates at least once. So tau refresh is minimum t, so that if I call j1 the coordinate that I pick at time 1, j2, etc., up to jt, we want that to be 1 up to n. the first time that we have picked every coordinate at least once. Then this time is a randomized stopping time, because in order to know whether it has happened or not by some time, it's not enough just to look at the values of the random walk that the random walk took, but we need to know which coordinates were picked, because one could pick a coordinate and not refresh it. So we cannot tell just by looking at the random walk whether all of the coordinates were picked or not. So this is a randomized stopping time. So I'm going to come back to this example, but now let me define. Yeah, so here Fn is the bit that we pick together with the bit that we put at time. So Fi is the sigma algebra generated by J1 B1 up to Ji Bi. So the point is that the sigma algebra does not just contain the values that the walk took at these times, but it contains extra information. So let me define now the randomized stopping time. So tau is called a randomized stopping time. If it is a stopping time for some Markovian filtration. So F, as I said, can contain extra randomness. So that's what I mean by that. And now, the definition of a stationary time. So tau is called a stationary time. So tau is a randomized stopping time. It's called a stationary time, and it could depend on the starting state x if at time tau we have reached stationarity. And here I have fixed the starting state x. And it's called a strong stationary time if not only we achieve stationarity at this time, but the value that the Markov chain takes at this time and the value of the time are independent random variables. So as above, if stationary plus x tau is independent of tau. The marker. Okay. So going back to this example of the lazy random walk on the hypercube, since at tau refresh we have picked all of the coordinates at least once, so we have updated all of the coordinates, at this time the state of the Markov chain has reached stationarity. So the stationary distribution here is simply the uniform distribution. And also, it doesn't matter how long it takes to reach this state, this is going to be independent of the state of the chain at this time. So, oh nice. Tau refresh is a strong stationary time. And I guess I could erase this part. And I would like to show one more example before I show how one can use strong stationary times to upper bound mixing. So again, this is from the Aldous Diaconis paper. Top to random. So suppose that we have a deck of N cards. And at every time, we pick the top card and we place it at a uniform location in the deck. Okay. So pick top card. Okay. Now let me define tau top to be the first time that the card that was originally at the bottom has reached the top plus one. I wait for it to go to the top and then I perform one more move. So it's one plus first time original bottom card. Then what I'm going to explain is that tau top is a strong stationary time. And that's a very nice argument. We're going to prove it by induction. So first of all, for time t, so I didn't say what we'll prove by induction. So by induction, we'll show that for all times t, the order of the cards below the original bottom card is uniform. So I'm going to do that by induction. So for t equal to 0, we don't have any card below the bottom card. So this is trivially true. And now suppose claim is true for t, we'll show for t plus 1. So since we assume that it's true for t, it means that at time t, the order of the cards below the bottom card is uniform. And then at time t plus 1, I'm going to pick the top card, and I'm going to place it at a uniform location. Either I'm going to place it below the original bottom card or above it. If I place it above it, then this is not going to ruin the order of the cards below the bottom card. And so since it was uniform, it stays uniform. However, if I place it under the original bottom card, then since I'm going to pick one location uniformly at random, this is this means that the order after this step is also uniform. Okay, so two cases. I'm sorry?
Can you write larger?
I'll write there larger because I don't have much space. So two cases, either above or below bottom card, the original bottom card. In this case, it stays uniform. In the second case, since we put it at a uniform location, it stays uniform. So this shows that also time t plus one, it is uniform. So at the first time that the original bottom card reaches the top, which is start of minus one, the order below it is uniform. And then we perform one more step and we place it at a uniform location. So at time tau top, the order of the deck is going to be uniform. So I'm going to come back to this example in a little bit. But first now I would like to explain a little bit how strong stationary times can be used to upper bound mixing time. So we define a strong stationary time to be a stationary time so that the value of the chain at this time and the value of the time are independent. So the first lemma, which follows easily, is that for all x and y, for all y, because say we fix x, this is pi of y. Let's prove that. So I'm just going to sum over all of the time, all of the possible values of tau. And I'm also going to sum over all of the possible locations of xs. And now I'm going to condition on tau equal to s and xs equal to z. So this is going to be pt minus s zy times the probability, because tau is a stopping time. But tau is a strong stationary time, so these two events are independent. So this is equal to that. And now taking the sum over all z of that is going to give us pi of y. And taking the sum over all s of this probability is going to give us the second lemma. Let me define the separation distance to be over pi. And after I prove that, this inequality, I'm going to comment on the cases of equality. So let me just write 1 minus ptxy over pi of y. This is just the definition. And I'm just going to lower bound this probability, so upper bound the quantity, by 1 minus I just inserted one more event. And now we know that this is the product. So this is 1 minus pi of y times the probability t divided by pi of y. And so these two cancel. So what we get is the probability that tau is greater than t. And now let me say something about the case of equality. So if we have a stopping time s, then z is a holding state. For s, if we must have stopped, if we have stopped before hitting z. So if we know that s is upper bound by tz, almost surely tz is the first hitting time of z. So we must have stopped before we reach the point z. So if we have now a strong stationary time, which has a holding state, let's go back to this proof. Suppose that y is the holding state, then in this case here, we would have an equality. And so this is showing, so this is also from Aldous and Diaconis in 87. It shows that among all stationary, strong stationary times, if a strong stationary time has a holding state, then it achieves the minimal expectation. But not only that, it has the optimal tails. So, among all strong stationary times, holding states have optimal tails. Why are you saying that? Yeah, I haven't finished. Yeah, so this is just about separation. So the total variation distance between the measure starting from x and pi is at most. Okay, sorry. So this is very easy. So we just write the total variation distance as the sum over all y, pi of y bigger than ptxy, which is this sum, and I'm going to take pi of y as a common factor. And obviously, all of that is upper bounded by Sx of t. And so in particular, it's upper bounded by the probability that I is greater than t. So this is showing how one can use strong stationary times to upper bound the total variation mixing. So going back to the example of the top to random, using this stopping time that I defined here, the tau top, one can get the order of the mixing, that it's at most n log n. A natural question is, can one find a stopping time, which is a randomized stopping, a strong stationary time, which is which has smaller expectation than this time tau top that I defined here. So here I define tau top as the first time that the card that started at the bottom, it reaches the top, and we also do one more move. So could we do any better? And from the proof, the induction argument started from t equal to 0. We have no cars below it. And then the rest was the induction argument. So suppose that we looked at the card that started second from the bottom. Then could that have smaller expectation if we wait for this card to reach the top and we also perform one more step? This is obviously a small, it has obviously smaller expectation, this stopping time. Now the question is, can we do even better than that? Can we find a stationary time which has smaller expectation? And in order to answer that, I'm going to give you, so here I said that among all strong stationary times, the ones with halting state have optimal mean and also optimal tails. But if I drop the assumption that the stopping time is strong stationary time, but it's just a stationary time, then this criterion actually becomes, if and this condition becomes if and only if. So that's what I'm going to show now, that among all stationary times, a stationary time has optimal mean if and only if it has a halting state. And this is a criterion due to Lovas and Winkler. Tz, sorry, it's just the first hitting time of z. It's the first time t that xt is equal to z. Not yet. I just explained here when we have equality. So let's look at, before I talk about general stationary times, let's go back to the lazy random walk on the hypercube. We defined tau refresh was defined as the first time that we have picked all of the bits at least once. And the question is, does this have a halting state? So suppose that we start from all zeros. Yeah, that's right. Exactly. So all ones is a halting state. Okay, so in generality, suppose that we have mu and nu, mu and rho. Two distributions, and they satisfy the probability starting from mu. And let S be a randomized stopping time such that the probability starting from mu that the value of the chain at time s is equal to x is equal to rho of x. So you can think of rho as being the stationary distribution, so sigma is a, so s is a stationary time. Then s is mean optimal, which means that it achieves the minimal expectation among all randomized times that have this property. Minimum u so the claim is that S is mean optimal in this sense even only if S has a holding state. So I'm only going to show one direction, that if S has a holding state, then it is mean optimal. So and the other direction uses a stopping time which is called the filling rule. And the construction of that goes back to the paper of Baxter and Chacon from 74. And one shows that this stopping time has a holding state. And then using similar ideas to the proof that I will present, one can show that if a stopping time is mean optimal, then it has to have a holding state. But now I'm going to only prove the other direction. So the idea is I'm going to define the exit frequencies from all states, so the number of times that we exit the state before the time s. And then I'm going to take another stopping time with different frequencies, and I'm going to show that the difference of the two frequencies satisfies a linear system, which is the same system as the one satisfied by the invariant distribution. And so that will mean that this difference of the two frequencies has to be a multiple of the invariant distribution, and then we'll see how that concludes the proof. So define exit frequencies. So for all x, I write mu of x to be the number of times, as I said, that we exit x up to time s minus 1. So let's try to rewrite mu of x. So mu of x is equal to the sum up to time s and I have to subtract the value at s, which is this probability. But we know that at time s we have reached the distribution rho, so this is, so nu of x So this is equal to rho of x. So we have mu of x plus rho of x is equal to this expectation. Okay. And now I'm going to rewrite this number of times that we visit x. So we visit x when we start with probability mu of x. And then for the remaining part, we are counting how many times we visit x up to time s. So I'm just going to sum over all of the points y, the exit frequency of y multiplied by the probability that from y we go to x. So it's the sum of all y, mu of y, byx, because s is a stopping time, so we can do that. Here I'm just, so this is for I equal to 0, and here for the remaining times, I just count how many times we visit x coming from y, and this is the exit frequency from y. So we get that mu of x plus rho of x is equal to mu of x plus this sum. These are the exit frequencies for s. So now let's take, let t be another stopping time with exit frequencies nu prime. Then nu prime will satisfy the same. And so if we subtract the two, then these terms cancel. So if I set d to be nu prime minus nu, then we get that d is equal to d times p. And this implies that d has to be a multiple alpha of the stationary measure for alpha some constant. And now we're going to use the assumption that S has a holding state. So if Z is the holding state, then it means that the exit frequency from Z is going to be 0. Mu Z is equal to 0. And so this means that mu prime of Z is equal to alpha pi of Z. So this implies that alpha has to be non-negative. And so what this is saying is that nu prime of x is at least nu of x for all x. And now we are almost done, because we want to show that s achieves the minimum, the minimal expectation. So the expectation of any other stopping time t is going to be the sum of mu prime of x over all x. And this is going to be at least the sum over all x of mu of x, which is the expectation of s. So going back to the hypercube, as we saw earlier, this has a halting state, so it achieves a minimal expectation. And now let's go back to the top to random shuffle. So we said that for the bottom card, we wait until it reaches the top. This is a stationary time. And we also saw that if we pick the second from the bottom card, this is also a stationary time. But the question is, can we do any better if we pick, say, the third card, or if we do something else? Could we achieve smaller expectation? So can we get smaller expectation? So now I'm restricting to the case where rho is equal to pi. So we are looking at stationary times. So as we said, when we look at the second to bottom card, the first time it reads the top plus one, it is a stationary time. But does it have a halting state? If we know that the original bottom card has reached the top, exactly. So this is a holding state. So this time, the time for the second from the bottom card to reach the top plus one, this indeed has minimal expectation because it has a holding state. So the answer is no, the second to bottom. And the last thing I want to say, so now I talked about stationary and strong stationary times. I explained how they can be used to upper bound mixing. But now I would like to go back to the first theorem and explain, just give the main idea how one proves that the geometric mixing is equivalent to the mixing of the lazy chain. So, for reversible. So as I said before, the way to prove that uses a similar technique to what Aldous used in his 81 paper. In particular, he used this notion of mixing, which I'm going to denote by T-stop, and is defined as follows. So we take the maximum over all starting states x, and then we take the minimum over the minimum is over all stopping times ux, which achieves stationarity. So such that the probability that x at this time ux is y. So ux is a stationary time for the point x. So a priori, it's not clear why this is ever achieved. But as I said before, there is a construction from 74 where they construct the so-called filling rule, which achieves this minimum. And what Aldous showed is that the mixing time is equivalent to this notion T-stop for reversible chains. I said that at the beginning. The chains are always lazy. Actually, he showed it for the continuous time. And then the way we prove it is we show that for reversible, T-stop is equivalent to TG. And the proof of that, one direction follows very easily, namely that the geometric mixing is always upper bounded by constant times T-stop, but the other direction uses very similar techniques to what Aldous used in his 81 paper. And I'll stop here.